Outside the Lines, first report, right now.
Got him! Ball game! Nunez is perfect.
We knew them, everyone knew them, rooted for them, and paid them as Leo Nunez and Fausto Carmona.
Carmona's sack delivers. Swing and a miss, he struck him out.
But these two major league pitchers from the Dominican Republic were recently revealed to be among the increasing number who used false identities and ages to sign their original baseball contracts.
It happened because when I started playing, I was 19, and I thought that was the way, that I could sign with a different age, 16. Because you know that here, when you start playing and you're 19 going on 20, the main thing is you're not going to sign. And that's what I did. And I was advised to do it. I had to do it.
My family lives off of me. You know what I mean? A lot of people here in my village, I help them. A lot of poor people also live off of me.
We'll meet one of the men whose identity was used by a player to begin his baseball career, as each pitcher must now fight to regain his U.S. visa and worry about baseball's discipline as well.
It's a sad moment because this kid made that mistake to do what he did, and all of a sudden this kid losing time, losing money. I think this kid is very, very disappointed, very embarrassed about the situation.
Today outside the lines, the two major leaguers stuck in the Dominican with the stories of their false identities.
And now, reporting for Outside the Lines, Bob Lee.
If spring training answers questions and sets lineups, then the Miami Marlins and the Cleveland Indians each have a huge issue. The Indians are without the pitcher they knew as Fausto Carmona, a 200-inning starter whose $7 million option they had picked up. Except Carmona is actually named Roberto Hernandez, and he is stuck right now in his native Dominican Republic. Same for Marlins closer Leo Nunez, who is actually named Juan Carlos Oviedo. He's been in the top 10 of games saved over the last 3 years. In the Dominican, the collision of incredible baseball skills, poverty, and the lure of signing bonuses at a young age has produced this spectacle, which is increasingly commonplace, except now it's halted the careers of two proven major leaguers, and it's got the full attention of the governments of both nations. Pedro Gomez examines these cases of false identity and real crisis.
Every offseason, dozens of Dominican major leaguers return to their home country. This pitcher, standing beside his poster in his hometown, has saved 92 games for the Marlins over the last 3 years. But the name on this poster has never appeared in a big league box score.
Got him! Ball game! Nunez is perfect!
The pitcher, who signed professionally 12 years ago as Leo Nunez, is really Juan Carlos Oviedo.
It sounds good, since it's my actual name. It makes me feel like I have my name by blood, which was given to me by my mother and my father, who has passed away.
Last spring, someone whose identity has not been revealed went to Dominican authorities and exposed Oviedo for lying about his identity. Oviedo was in the U.S. on fraudulent documents, and in September, he was summoned back to the DR and arrested by Dominican police at the U.S. consulate in Santo Domingo. He had been using this visa, falsely claiming the name Leo Nunez and 1983 as his year of birth. Oviedo was really born in 1982, so he was 29 at the time, not 28.
Carmona sack delivers. Swing and a miss, he struck him out.
In January, another prominent Dominican pitcher was also busted for identity fraud. Cleveland right-hander Fausto Carmona has been a starter for the Indians since 2006. But his real name is Roberto Hernandez, and he was 31 at the time Dominican police arrested him, not 28 as listed.
It happened because when I started playing, I was 19, and I thought that was the way, that I could sign with a different age, 16. Because you know that here, when you start playing and you're 19 going on 20, the main thing is you're not going to sign. And that's what I did. And I was advised to do it. I had to do it.
According to Hernandez, in December, a stranger exposed his real identity on Dominican radio.
Roberto, how did we get to this point where somebody went on the radio and said to the entire Dominican audience, that is not Fausto Carmona?
Someone looking or trying to blackmail me, put pressure on me, looking for money.
Hernandez says he refused to meet the blackmailer's demands and that the broadcast led to Hernandez's arrest.
That day, as we say here, the sky fell on me. I didn't know what to think at the time.
Oviedo reflected on the day of his arrest.
I'm now realizing that I made that mistake. And that's why I confessed that wasn't my name, Leo Nunez. That my name is Juan Carlos Oviedo.
Oviedo introduced us to the real Leo Nunez, a childhood friend he turned to when he sought a new identity. We spoke with Nunez at Oviedo's farm in the town of Bonao, an hour north of Santo Domingo.
When he came to you and asked you, what were your thoughts?
You didn't know what was going to happen, how far he could make it, and I told him, that's fine, no problem. Yes, I lent him my identity, and no doubt he was going to go through this. But the time has come, and he has to face things.
Why did you do it?
I did it because since we were kids, we were like brothers, a friendship from school days, playing, riding bikes, and just imagine a close friend. When you love someone like that, as a brother, how do you say no?
Unlike Oviedo, Hernandez says he doesn't have a close relationship with the man whose identity he assumed.
Who is the real Fausto Carmona?
I mean, a far removed relative, but we don't have much to do with each other.
This is the area Hernandez grew up in, and this house closely resembles the one where his parents raised him and his six siblings. Hernandez said that in order to get his family out of poverty, he was willing to do almost anything, including falsifying his name and age.
I wanted to improve things for my family, and that was the way that I could do it.
My family lives off of me, you know what I mean? A lot of people here in my village, I help them. A lot of poor people also live off of me.
Oviedo and Hernandez say that as they advance through the minors, they feared their darkest secret might be revealed.
I felt a lot of pressure every time that I'd move up from division to division because I knew that each time my name was growing bigger. I knew that at some point they would find out about me, and I felt a lot of pressure.
Every year, as I saw my progress going up and up, I had that on my mind. I think about my name, you know. I always think, and as I just said, I was a little afraid of doing it because I come from humble beginnings.
Hernandez and Oviedo remain in the DR, and both say they're cooperating with authorities. Dominican criminal charges against them have been dropped, but neither Hernandez nor Oviedo has been able to obtain the necessary paperwork to re-enter the U.S.
Make sure you do what you're supposed to do. Get ready.
Meanwhile, New Orleans manager Ozzie Guillen is without the established reliever Oviedo.
We want him here, of course. He helped us. He's a big part of the ball club. It's a sad moment because this kid made a mistake to do what he did. And all of a sudden, this kid losing time, losing money. And I think this kid is very, very disappointing, very embarrassed about the situation.
And Indians manager Manny Acta doesn't have Hernandez, a workhorse starter.
For me, it's tough because you don't find 200 innings in every corner in the United States. That's something that you value because he really contributes big time, not only to our club, but also for the development of our young kids.
Many Dominican players like Reds pitcher Johnny Cueto routinely renew their work visas to return to the U.S. for spring training. Oviedo and Hernandez remain in limbo, awaiting a U.S. government ruling in their cases. the U.S. Embassy in Santo Domingo declined an interview request by Outside the Lines, saying it could not comment on individual cases, but added, "The consequences of visa fraud are quite serious and can include ineligibility for life to travel to the United States. This is why the embassy works very closely with Major League Baseball to combat age and identity fraud." The two big league pitchers with uncertain futures say they are telling examples for anyone who is considering or has committed identity fraud.
If they have that same problem, let them step forward. Stand up for what they did, you know? So that they can try to straighten things up with the name that God gave them.
What I would tell them is that I don't want them to go through what I was going through and share that same message with the kids who are growing up now and haven't signed yet, so they don't go through what I went through. The fans, what I want to do is apologize for what has happened. I hope to go back there and play again, and I hope they'll forgive me.
Pedro Gomez reporting. He now joins us this afternoon. Pedro, let's take a deep breath and a step back and review the legal implications and the situations for both Oviedo and Hernandez. Where do they stand?
Well, they've basically already cleared themselves with the Dominican government. Of course, the Dominican government isn't the most important player in this case, because in order for them to get back with their respective clubs here in the States, they need to get the approval of the U.S. government, and that's the holdup right now. Now, they're absolutely in talks with the government, trying to get themselves the visa in order to return to work, one with the Marlins, one with the Indians. However, the government is basically putting them in a corner, almost in a timeout, where until they decide that maybe these players have been punished enough, they won't receive that visa to get back here to get with their clubs.
You're speaking about the U.S. consulate in Santo Domingo making that determination.
The U.S. consulate, of course, in connection with Washington, D.C.
State Department. Yeah.
It's all going through the State Department, exactly. Homeland Security is involved, all of that. And these are charges that they take very seriously, because even though these are major league pitchers, they don't want to set the bar where anybody can start to say, hey, I'm a world-class soccer player, let me in, and it could be a terrorist. So it's a very delicate situation.
And of course, we have the continuing specters we'll talk about a little bit later in the program. This is a very common problem. But getting into the United States on a legal U.S. visa is one issue. The other issue is getting back into baseball's good graces. How difficult will that be?
Well, Major League Baseball will probably not be that difficult to get back into. There probably will be some sort of a suspension from the commissioner's office, and that could be 2, 4, 6, 8 weeks. Who knows how long? You can expect some form of a suspension, but it won't be anything that's going to alter their career significantly. It'll just be a matter of weeks, maybe a couple of months, until they're back in. Almost as though you look at it kind of like a 50-game suspension for using PEDs, for it to be in that type of area.
Any indication that if their visa issue carries over into the regular season and starts costing the regular season games, that baseball may in effect count that as time served for their baseball discipline?
There is that possibility. This is uncharted territory, really, for Major League Baseball. So there absolutely is, especially when you think about how Manny Ramirez was viewed in a similar circumstance when he got busted last year for a second time. It was supposed to be a 100-game suspension, but baseball reduced it to 50 because he decided not to play again the rest of the season. So there very well could be that aspect where baseball could very well use that. Okay.